So, high-yield soybeans, through the fence. What is your definition of high-yield? You know, some people high-yield 60 bushel, although I wouldn't think that too much anymore, but it's possible. 80, 100 bushel. Where do you want to go with your beans, and what is sustainable? Most of all, what's profitable? How much time do you spend on what you're going to plant for beans? I used to be worked for Monsanto and seed and stuff. I heard a lot of times in years past that they'd spent agonizing hours what corn to plant. They said, well, give me a few pods of a 3 and a 3.5 and a 3.8. That's their decision on beans. We're not going to hit high yield beans that way. Another guy said the theory that beans are a crop I grow to plant corn. That's not going to get it done either. You know, we're challenged to feed the world. And a lot of times we talk about that 2050, like we heard from both speakers this morning. My question is, who's going to pay us for those beans? Because if we don't make money, we're not going to be in this business very long. So while I'm going to throw some ideas at you, I'm also going to share with you what we think your return is. Yield is decided by so many things, and it's more than NP and K. So many more things. What depth do you plant at? What kind of tillage? You know, disease packages, standability. There's so many things that affect yield, so much more than what people think about, for the most part, that it all enters into it. The bulk of my material naturally is going to come from our Brandt Research Farms. We have farms in Pleasant Plains and Lexington. Our farms are wrapped around practical agriculture. It's stuff that growers can easily do themselves. It's not pie in the sky. Now, we do have areas of farms set up for pipeline stuff, but the bulk of what we talk about, and what I'm going to talk to you today about, is stuff you can do today. We arrive at this through omission trials. Everybody knows Fred Velo, and he's talked about the 7 secrets of corn and the 6 secrets of soybeans, the omission trial basis, where the full treatment's out there, and we remove one treatment at a time, just see what return is for that treatment. That's our information is wrapped by that theory. As I said, we got a farm in Lexington and a farm in Pleasant Plains. There is the standard treatments for the Pleasant Plains farm. Nothing outrageous or different about that. There's a standard treatment for Lexington. So I'm going to talk about pole positions. And at Brandt, we talk about pole positions with our total acre program. It's a systems approach to your crops. And what it wraps around is what affects the yield the most and what's your return on investment. Now, as we talk about this, you notice these are just dollar signs. Those are management decisions you guys make that don't really cost you a dime. You know, when do I plant it? What variety do I plant? What maturity do I plant? It doesn't cost you any more, for the most part, on those three decisions. But yet, they make the most difference on yield. We'll talk about maturity, seed treatments, down through the line. I'm going to go through each one of these with you today. And the data I'm going to show with you is a minimum of 3 years data, and many are much longer than that. So the first one, planting date. You know, it used to be we didn't think about planting beans till after May 7th. When I was growing up on the farm, we raised seed beans, and they told us nothing in the ground before May 8th. Well, that's changing. With seed treatments, we can put beans in the ground earlier. We can get a yield response by planting earlier. We can also lower our populations planting earlier. This is a seed treatment trial from this year at Pleasant Plains. We had basically a 50 bushel reduction in yield from April 13th to the 25th of May. 50 bushel. And yes, that was 100 bushel beans. I saw we had some of the growers in here that had the 100 bushel beans on your setup this year. My congratulations to you guys that do that. It takes work. But there's the standard treatment for that timing trial as far as planting timing. And nothing really outrageous that most people wouldn't consider trying. So if we look back 2013, 14, 15, and 16, There's our different timing trials. You've got the dark blue here, last part of March up till April 15th, depending on the season. April 15th to April 30th, April 30th to May 10th, and after May 15th. And pretty consistently, here's the average. That last half of April has always been a prime time for planting soybeans. You lower your population to 120,000. Put that, if you've not been using seed treatments, put that savings towards paying for a really good seed treatment. Now, we all know that Mother Nature can throw us a curveball, throw us a frost in April, that won't be helpful to us, but that hasn't happened for quite a while and really doesn't happen through Central Illinois. It does happen, but not that often. Variety. What do you look at when you pick out varieties? Do you take time picking out varieties, or are you like the guy that just says, well, give me a few pallets of this maturity and that maturity? You know, seed companies have gotten a lot better at defining their strengths of certain varieties and where to position those, just like you would think of corn. You know, we've even got growers starting to create their own databases. How many varieties do you plant? And with things changing almost as fast as they change for corn, my suggestion is for the average grower, 500 acres of beans to higher. The more acres, once you get above 1,000 acres, the more varieties, but at least start at, say, four or five varieties, and every year keep your best and look at something new, one or two new ones. Always keep in mind, though, track records, because yield is genetic by environment, and every time we change our growing environment from weather, it will affect yield. Who do you get your information from? And I got a question I want to ask you guys. How many of you guys spend time on the internet in the blogs? Raise your hand. Let's be honest. How many guys like to visit Ag Talk and share ideas on there? Do you trust the information you get on that? Now, I'm not trying to be real critical, but I got to share my thought. I look at Ag Talk, I get information from there. When I get a guy talking from South Dakota to a guy in Mississippi about needing to use sulfur more, or needing to use gypsum more, or what's it cost you to buy a ton of DAP, I'm thinking, God, guys, really? What happens if you trust the wrong guy? We've been there, right? Maturity. I'm going to challenge you to get out of your comfort zone. Challenge you to plant a little longer maturity. If your comfort zone stops at 3.4, I'm going to tell you, plant a 3.6. If your comfort zone stops at a 3.6, I'll tell you, plant a 3.8. If your comfort zone stops at 3.8, go to 4.1. A gentleman sitting right back over here I used to work for in a grain business. Michael, how many times we see 8, 9% beans come across the elevator scales? Way too much. That's money in your pocket. Put that moisture back in and pick up another 5 bushel an acre. And guess what? They're not going to pay you for what you would have brought through the scales, what you brought across the scales. We look at trials since 2011. I don't have to show you any numbers. You can see the stair step to the right. We started a 3.2 and go to a 4.2. Now, granted, not too many guys over the eastern side of the state, straight across here, are going to plant a 4.2. Although I got some guys planting 4.1s. But at that, spread your risk. If you're farming 3,000 acres of beans, not even to go that high, but if you got a substantial number of acres of beans, you tell me, hey, I can't go that late. Guess what? While you're going a step or two later, go a step or two earlier and spread your risk out, but at least let's start taking some beans across the scales. They're at 13%. There's a big buzzword over the last 5 years that's changed a lot. It allows us to plant earlier. Protects against diseases, improves plant vigor, allows us to lower our population. Hey, there's some dollars return there too, isn't there? A must in high residue situations. Now, the data I'm gonna share with you is mainly Acceleron. There's a lot of companies out here selling seed treatments. It just happens that's what we have in our seed treatment systems. So that's why I'm showing you that data, because that's what I have. So basic Acceleron starts out in the base treatment as a basic standard elite. Basic's just basically A1 is what they call it. Standard A3, elite is A1 Poncho Vativo. To me, if you're doing anything less than this, you're doing a disservice to yourself. And I'll show you why. 007, now, that is a new seed treatment that Monsanto's released, and in, at least within Brandt organization, it's base on all our seed treatments, so get that treatment. It improves flowability, and that's not only good for them because it helps their seed treater stay cleaner, it's gonna help you. If you got center-filled tanks, and you've had problems with seed lodging in the tank, this takes care of that. And it makes it look a lot nicer too, which really doesn't mean anything in the pocket, but it makes you feel better. Here's the new one, and this is really when I think about the revolution coming to agriculture, here's where it's gonna really kick in. We went through our herbicide resistance and our insect resistance. So the next big era coming to agriculture is gonna be in furrow around that seed. How can we create an environment where we have nutrients more available to that plant? Because there's a lot of people starting to believe, you know, for years we said like corn decided its yield, mainly at V7, decided how many rows around. So a lot of people starting to believe, soybeans especially, start deciding yield just as it's popping through the ground. A lot of it based on nutrients available to it. So if we can create a microcosm of large mineralization happening right around that seed, it's gonna do nothing but increase yield. So this kind of stuff is exciting. I'm actually in on our research farms, we're looking at about 3 or 4 different products along this line this coming year to where it will affect both mineralization and help the seed and thus the root system the ability to uptake nutrients faster and quicker. We looked at Levo. If you've had a lot of problems with sudden death, I think there's a good benefit there. Is it a major player? I don't think you'll see it be a major player, but for areas it will be important. So I sorted out the Levo just because we looked at it for 2 years, and I didn't want to have it across the whole scheme of things. And in 2 years' time, it is averaging better. But as I said, A1 Poncho Vativo right here, to me, is the standard where we start. As we get looking further into it here, A1 PV plus an inoculant on average since 2011. Now, skewed a little bit here because we didn't have the inoculant in 2011, but A1 PV definitely is a standard bearer. And here's what I'll say about inoculants. I believe that once we cross that 65-70 bushel threshold on soybeans, we're not producing enough nitrogen. We have to assist that soybean plant. That's key for higher yielding soybeans. So if you're in that era that you really want to push beans, I think you need to consider inoculants. And I'll show you some data more so about why I believe that. Seed treatments, this spring was a rough spring. These beans were planted April 25th. We know it turned off cool and damp. I don't know how well you can see this, but you got a pretty thin stand here, A1 by itself, next to A1 Poncho Vativo. Here's A1, A1 Poncho Vativo. You can see right to the row, if nothing else, the difference there, and it's stand count. What was even more dramatic, July 15th, I had some growers that wanted a tour of the farm, so we looked through different trials. Standing here, it looked like everything was the same. That day they went over with a plane to take their overhead pictures to use in our research farm book, and guess what from the plane it looked like? You can pick out the difference in seed treatments from above. And that's shocking. That's the exact same day I took the photo. You would never believe that. But you can see our trucks where they were parked when we started our tour. Pleasant Plains. That same day, they took the arrow shot there, and you can see right where he used the Poncho Vativo and where he didn't. So I am a huge supporter of Poncho Vativo. I'd buy stock if I could. I'm too poor. You know, sometimes I think too much. Anybody ever wonder where baby oil came from? You like the guy to start with a lot better than this one, I guess, huh? Let's talk about sulfur. We know we don't have the sulfur we used to. You know, we don't have the trains belching and the factories running. Mother Nature's not giving us that sulfur through the rain like it used to. Just highlight real here, Pleasant Plains, 85 bushel. This was their seed treatment without sulfur. Seed treatment with sulfur, 95 bushel. Lexington, in 2015, same thing, top two with sulfur. 2016, sulfur. We're using 14 pounds of sulfur. Roughly five, it's actually 14.4. We're using 5 gallon ammonium thiosulfate. Don't forget it on your corn either. Big bump on corn. But we're talking about beans today.
What was sulfur in your soil at that time prior to application?
Basically, through all the soil tests across the farms, right at university recommendations. Yeah?
How do you want that water?
So, if you're in 30 inch rows or wider, I'd band it. If you're under 30 inch rows, broadcast it with your herbicides. If you can band it, if not, broadcast it. Sulfur is even more mobile than nitrates. Several trials will tell you the optimal rate of sulfur is 14 to 16 pounds the acre. 5 gallons is an easy thing to remember, and that's 14.4 pounds. Now, there's guys will ask me, what about elemental? Elemental has to convert to sulfate for the plant to take it up. If you want to use elemental, put it on the fall with your dry. Otherwise, stay with a sulfate form in the spring, but don't apply sulfate in the spring because, like I said, it leaches worse than nitrates. It'll be gone before you need it. There's how I put it on. Now, granted, I don't farm 5,000 acres, but I've got a little adapter put on right behind the wheel and drop it on at 2x0 right on top of the row, and the seed's 2 inches down. Those units are like $20 a row. Granted, you got to have tank and pumps and everything else, but we're not talking about a big item.
So you're just putting it on top.
Now, do you feel like you're under attack with all these ideas already starting? Changing how you think you need to do business, changing ideas. Strobes, fungicides. You know, with strobes, they've got to be applied before the disease breaks out. They're not a curative, they're a preventer. But the thing about strobes is they stop the ethylene gas in the plant, which is important. Ethylene gas in a plant causes the plant to die prematurely, thus limiting yield. So by applying a strobe, it reduces plant stress because it stops any disease from growing. It slows maturity of the plant to let that plant reach its full yield potential because we're stopping or slowing down the production of ethylene gas. Since 2008, a 4.4 bushel advantage on beans with strobes. Yeah.
What's the application time?
Depends yearly. If you've got a dry year and under stress, I'll apply it just prior to R1. If it's a healthy, good growing year like last year, I'll apply it closer to R3. And that's the thing, we got to be flexible in this stuff as to when the plant's going to get the most use out of it. Cover crops. There's a buzzword that seems to come up on us. I love cover crops ahead of beans. They sequester nitrogen left over from a corn crop. What did I say earlier about beans over 65 bushel, what they're limited on the most? Nitrogen. Cereal rye, even planted late, does a great job. We're seeing positive results yield-wise. Now, here is a study last spring at Pleasant Plains. This area across here is all no-till. This is also no-till, and this all is conventional till. Now, the difference is, in these no-till strips right here, that's about first, second trifoliate when this picture was taken, but there was a cover crop on this block, there was no cover crop here, and that's conventional. Now you look at that, how enthused would you be about putting no cover crop in front of your soybeans? Doesn't look too good, does it? There's August. Now if you can tell it overhead, where this cover crop was, a lot greener. Without the cover crop, no-till is a lot yellower. Really, this no-till and this conventional, health-wise, in an NDVI look very similar. So what happened? No-till after cover crop, 6 bushel over conventional, almost 10 bushel better than no-till without the cover crop. Do we need nitrogen on soybeans? Do you have a question? Yeah, burn it off early. Early by meaning, if I'm going to plant 20th of April, I want that sprayed with a burn down the 1st of April, at the latest, maybe the last half of March. Now, why do I believe cover crops? When I look at where I'm putting nitrogen on the soybeans, remember I showed you the 10 bushel no-till with without cover crop? Seeing the same number virtually on where I'm putting nitrogen and sulfur, or just nitrogen versus without. Those attachments I showed you in the planter earlier, on some of my trials I'm putting nitrogen as well as sulfur. I'm putting 15 pounds of nitrogen with a 14 pounds of sulfur, 2x0 right on top of the ground. And by the way, monothiazide sulfate will act as urease inhibitor to help protect that nitrogen until we get a shower to get in the ground. We're a 9 bushel advantage over the last 2 years. Bus station where bus stops, train station where train stops. I got a workstation at my desk. Some guys think I don't do any work. You know, think about it, it's pretty boring. And I add these in because who wants to come in here and look at nothing but data? Oh, wait a minute, that's what I do for a job. Kind of depressing. Insecticides. Now you'll see some NAs in here. That refers to like cover crop we didn't have cover crops in, or that area flooded out or caused dramatic damage that the trial wouldn't be fair. Just point that out. But, and I didn't really talk about the average yield increases, but like cover crop, average over the time period, almost 5 bushel. We're looking pretty much 5 bushel. 9 bushel, 10. We're here at a 4 bushel bump for foliar insecticide. And insect pressure changes from year to year. But we know there's a synergistic effect between fungicide and insecticides. We've seen it time and again. It's also a great time to add boron. We'll talk about that in a little bit. Foliar insecticide R2 to R3 on average, a 4.5 bushel bump for the insecticide part. Now if we go further on boron, if you look at the effect it has when you spray fungicides, that's even a greater bump. So like I said, that synergistic effect, I just forgot to throw that in here. P and K rate, now we're gonna raise some fire in here. I know somebody's gonna start getting ready to leave when I say this. But do you fertilize for corn and hope you got enough left for the beans? Or do you fertilize in front of each crop? And that is the challenge I'm going to put to you guys today if you're trying to raise high-yield beans. 200 and 200. DAP potash. How many guys are in that range of 200 and 200 in their fertilizer in the fall? A few fans. If you raise 235 bushel corn, 60 bushel beans, and spread 200, 200, you're 100 pounds short on DAP and 40 pounds short of potash. And I challenge you from the standpoint that we've had some crops a lot better than 235 and better than 60. And there's guys that aren't even doing that. Now I realize that we fight budgets and you got to have money left over. Fertilizer is the last place you want to cheat, because we've been cheating this one too many years. You know, sometimes you wonder, do folks really want to know what's going on? It'd be interesting to see what happens to that foiler when he backs up, wouldn't it? Okay, now we're going to talk about a subject that, frankly, I called snake oil for years. Foliar treatments, you know, spraying snake oil. I truly believe that. However, I'm finding that it's all about the delivery system. And to explain that, first off, what do our micronutrients and foliars do? You know, manganese improves herbicide metabolism and disease tolerance, assists in photosynthetic and respiration. Zinc stimulates root and shoot growth and chlorophyll production. Sulfur, important for protein and enzyme synthesis, promotes nodulation of legumes. Manganese, chlorophyll production, photosynthesis, carbohydrate and protein synthesis, boron cell division, cell wall formation, nitrogen metabolism, reproduction seed set. Molybdenum, essential for nodule formation of legumes, component of protein synthesis, and calcium, cell wall structure and production, and nutrient transport and retention. That's a lot of big words, too much to say at one time. But all that's pretty important. And not all of that can the plant get through its system when it's busy pulling everything else through, and it may not be available enough in the soil. So what made me change my mind away from snake oil? Sitting down with a chemist was the start of it, and then looking at plot data. And I'll try not to make this a commercial, but there is a difference. And you don't have to be a Brandt customer to buy this stuff, because we sell, actually, we sell a lot of this through different distributors through our special formulation group, so you can get it from anybody. East Coast CPS buys over $1 million worth of this stuff every year. I found that out recently. The big thing about it is right there. We use a sugar alcohol carrier to transport this stuff. Plants love sugar. Sugar is essential in photosynthesis production of proteins. So what happens, we spray our herbicide or our insecticide or a fungicide. First off, let's talk herbicides. I don't care if it's Roundup tolerant, you spray Roundup on it. It's dicamba tolerant, you spray dicamba on it. It has to metabolize that. So I will be the first person to tell you, I don't advertise that these Brandt foliar treatments are there for a nutritional level first. But what they do once they get in the plant triggers some things that help the plant. If you've got a headache, you take an aspirin. We spray these crops with herbicides or fungicides or insecticides. It has to metabolize that. It's got a headache. Spraying these products can trigger things within the plant, just like an aspirin does for your headache. It helps pick up metabolize. It helps pick up metabolism with that plant. So it quickly runs that through the system. The other thing about the carrier we're using, it breaks it down, makes it longer and smaller diameter, so it's easier to get in a plant. It keeps the surface of the plant wet longer, so it has more time to get in the plant. So, I mean, you've heard for years people talk about herbicides and the carrier being important for that. It's just as important, if not more so, here. So Smart Trio, the guys up here talk about, they tried some Smart Trio. That's the aspirin, big way in helping metabolize whatever you're spraying on. Sulfur, boron, zinc, and manganese. And I'm big on boron. Eight-year average, 5.4 bushel with and without Trio. I wish I was the chemist, I could describe how this works, but I'm not. I did a poor job. But when I look at five bushel, what are cash beans today? Somebody.
10 and a quarter.
Okay, I'm slow, so let's say $10. That's 50 bucks for a $4 treatment. I can make money on that.
Doing that with the herbicide pass?
I will spray Trio. I'll qualify that here in a second. You'll understand why. But I will spray Trio on a herbicide pass, insecticide pass, fungicide pass. If I've got a crop that's under stress and turning yellow, I will go out and spray just Trio on it. And I've seen it respond. As stupid as that sounds. But for $4 an acre, what the hell? Smart Bee. Now, last year was the first year for Smart Bee. We used to sell Bee Molly or N-Boron. We've actually changed our production, and because boron is so important, we found a way that we actually double the amount of boron we can get in the plant with this product. You know, boron is really critical in a plant, corn and soybeans both. It's just alfalfa. If you think about, you had a straw, that corn plant's a straw trying to take nutrients up. Adding boron into that plant is like loosening that straw so it can take more up. Five bushel on boron, again roughly a $4 treatment. We talk about synergistic effect with boron and fungicides. There's fungicides with and without boron. 5 minutes, right? You need to really move. All right.
So you're spraying the boron at R1, R3?
Whenever I'm spraying the fungicide.
You got a shot of Smart Trio in front of that too then?
I'll actually put Smart Trio on both times. Quattro is our new product. Basically take Trio and boron, put it together, and left out the nitrogen, and hope is that will be on, it has been submitted to the chemistry companies to get approved on their dicamba tolerance because we left that nitrogen out. So, will it be approved this year? I doubt it happens this year. They've got a lot of things they gotta get on label first. But my spin on it, I will use Quattro on soybeans because I'm gonna get the benefits of the Trio and boron at one time. And I'll use Trio followed by Smart Bee on corn. And Boost 5. This is something that Randy Dowdy, we're not going to have time to watch it because I talked too long. I need to speed up and change some things here for the next guys. I'm sorry. Randy Dowdy tried this product. It was something new that we've been playing with. And he saw a huge response. And basically this, in a nutshell, boosts the plant's availability to metabolize and uptake nutrients. So we're just starting to play with this, so you won't see any studies on this. Just letting you know this is what we're going to be looking at now for the next couple years. Population we talked about. You plant earlier, you can lower populations. Lower populations are out yielding higher populations. Went 120, 140, and 160,000. We overplant beans, underplant corn, folks. We still do. 30 or 15 is either one. You know, we can't keep doing things like have been, and because we've got to wrap up here. We have opportunities now with dicamba-tolerant crops. And you've heard it time and again, we cannot treat that like we did Roundup. If we treat dicamba like Roundup, we've lost all our guns. Because dicamba and 2,4-D dealings, we got working for us for water hemp and Palmer. And if a farmer sprayed Roundup and Marvel last year and he switched to Liberty and Phoenix, we talk about needing at least two modes, sites of action. Do we have two sites of action there? Active sites of action? No. Because basically, Marvel and Phoenix are both 14s. Be thinking about your herbicide plans. Going back to the thought about cover crops, be thinking about your corn herbicide plans so it doesn't affect growing your cereal rye. If you're going to control tough to kill weeds, that's the way to do it. Don't let them emerge. On the farm this year, and I'm not promoting this as the only thing to use, I'm just telling you what I used was very effective because I had a water hemp problem the previous year. I put boundary down and followed a prefix. The only thing I had escape was velvet leaf. I'll throw 2 ounces of pursuit with my prefix this year to take care of them. But there are a lot of good programs out there, but be thinking about what you want to use and don't plan on killing it post-emerge. There. This is what's scary. How many guys put out more CPR, CRP acres, used pollinator seed? Anybody in here? They found there was Palmer seeds in that. Anybody aware of that story, what's going on? You know, this guy had 3 acres of beans, got overtaken with Palmer. Next year it grew to 6 acres, even with a buffer around it. Aaron Hager said they found more than one company that, for some, whatever reason, Palmer was in those pollinator seed bags. And there's what was scattered across the Midwest. So be on the lookout, be careful. Don't have time for Randy, unfortunately. If a guy wants to play with something and try some areas for high yield, there's what I'm trying. I've got a sheet up here. If you're really interested in trying it, there's a sheet up here of this you can take a look at. The key thing, remember, we must unlearn what we've learned and do things a little different. And if you're going to go down that path and try doing a high yield field, take your best field and just see what is attainable for you. You don't try it. You do it or you don't do it. Because it's going to dynamically change how you're normally doing your operation. And I recommend doing it on one farm because you need to make sure it's going to work for you, the different things you need to try and do. With that, I'm going to stop. Any questions?
Have you done any research on variable rate population?
On soybeans? No. I've seen some, and basically where I'm seeing the benefit is you've got some high pH areas. I see some real good benefits there. I have not any growers asked me to do that yet. You know, I got quite a few acres of corn, but I haven't had anybody doing beans yet. I've talked to a couple guys about it where they've got some high pH pockets, but don't have a planter able to do it, so.
On your response to boron, is that for higher pot set or better pot fill?
Both. And a lot of that's variety sensitive. Some varieties will actually put out more pods, some is just a bigger pod fill. Anybody else?
Do you have any recommendations for shortening intervals?
Spray an ALS on it. You know. Not, I guess, we've got to ask why.
Well, I'm just tired of 6.5 foot tall beans with pods.
Yeah. So potentially we knew we shortened internodes when we threw ALS herbicides at it, like Pursuit and Raptor. Maybe it'd be something good for me to add this year to that trial where if I'm going to actually use some Pursuit with my prefix, kick the rate up to 4 ounces and see if I do shorten internodes. That'd be a good trial. Anybody else?
You talked about maturities for beans. You going to plant your early ones first or you going to plant your later ones?
Late ones first. Give them all the time I can. Anybody else? Thank you very much, guys.